स्टार्ट।
डेंगू हो इज अ कॉमन फीवर।
इंट्रोड्यूस योरसेल्फ।
आई एम डॉक्टर रतन। डन माय इंटरनल मेडिसिन फ्रॉम सेंट लुक्स हॉस्पिटल मिजोरी। डन माय एमबीबीएस फ्रॉम उस्मानिया मेडिकल कॉलेज हैदराबाद एंड आई एम डूइंग करेंटली डीएम कार्डियोलॉजी एट जेएनएमसी बेलगाम।
And you have been practicing here?
I have been practicing in Guntur as a general physician for the last 10 years.
Okay.
I have practiced for 2 years as a hospitalist in US. So, in terms of dengue fever, dengue, as you know, is acquired by mosquito bite. And it's common nowadays that most people are dying with dengue because of high mortality due to septic shock. Or shock, as you know. The way I have seen dengue causing the end organ damage in human beings is that it causes liver and or kidney damage, leading to anuria as well as end stage liver disease, which is otherwise called liver failure. Dengue as such cannot raise the fever like hepatitis, cannot raise the liver enzymes as hepatitis. When we see liver enzymes are elevated, it is most likely that dengue has caused some sort of septic or process initiation in the body, as well as elevation of creatinine. As most of the viruses can cause liver enzymes elevation, but dengue cannot, as such, cannot cause liver enzyme elevation. So, what we have to think in clinical terms is when we see liver enzyme elevation, most likely OT and PT, SGOT and SGPT, along with bilirubin, especially when they cross 100, OT and PT, and the bilirubin when it crosses 1.5, we have to be very careful in arresting the septic process, underlying septic process. The same terms will apply for creatinine. If we see more than 1.5 creatinine, we have to be very careful in managing underlying septic process. The best antibiotics I have tried are doripenem and fosfomycin. If the patient can afford, the combination is better at any point of time when we see bilirubin more than 1.5 and or creatinine 1.5. If a patient can't afford, at least we have to put them on doripenem. We have to put them on doripenem to see if there is any improvement in the bilirubin and creatinine in the first 12 hours. In the first 12 hours, if there is no improvement with doripenem, we definitely have to add on fosfomycin to doripenem, even if the creatinine and bilirubin are more than 1.5 and not cross 2.5. If the bilirubin and creatinine have crossed 2.5, we definitely have to go for doripenem plus fosfomycin, BD, 2 times a day is good enough. If the patient can afford, doripenem 3 times a day is much more better. At any point of time, if the patient's blood pressure has dropped below 100, even though the creatinine and bilirubin are normal, we better start with doripenem plus fosfomycin. Regarding liver enzymes, OT and PT, if they cross 100, and the bilirubin is normal or the creatinine is normal, the patient is much better. We can safely observe for a couple of days, but if the patient is looking sick, or if there is any abdominal tenderness, or if there are definitely if the bilirubin and the creatinine are rise, we definitely have to go for those two antibiotics. Other than that, platelet count is not the factor for determining underlying sepsis process. Fever is not also the factor for determining septic stage. Rest of the things are neurological signs. If the patient is neurologically deteriorated, we better go for. Generally, we see creatinine and bilirubin rise, but if the patient is neurologically deteriorated, we can safely start doripenem and fosfomycin. Usually, the patient's septic process will be arrested within 72 hours. So, if the patient cannot afford beyond 72 hours, we can send them home after giving 72 hours of IV antibiotics of doripenem and fosfomycin. In my clinical practice, regarding the cost-wise, It is coming to 8,000 per day and 24,000 for a total of 3 days. So altogether along with the hospital bill, it should be less than 50,000.
And can you explain this chart? 1 minute. Okay, explain this chart.
In this chart, I've also graded one more stage, which is having bilirubin and creatinine less than 1.5. In which time we can start piperacillin tazobactam or meropenem. That is usually stage 1. But what I talked to you previously is about stage 2 and 3. More than 1.5 bilirubin and creatinine. So the blind way of remembering all these things in mind is 1.5. 1.5, either bilirubin or creatinine. Go for doripenem and phosphomycin. If not, doripenem.
Okay.
Thank you.
So why you are going to antibiotics?
So the rationale for doripenem plus or minus phosphomycin is pseudomonas. It covers mostly pseudomonas. The prevalent bacteria in dengue fever and low end immunity is pseudomonas, from what I have seen. When you want to cover with tigecycline or colistin or any other gram-positive coverage, it's not totally safe because none of the gram-positive bacteria or Klebsiella or E. coli are going to be prevalent, or you may not see them in blood cultures. But most likely Pseudomonas is the prevalent bacteria I have seen.
And you are seeing hypotension less than 100?
Hypotension is most likely caused by Pseudomonas. And Pseudomonas is the most prevalent organism in dengue fever.
And gram-negative, you will see this hypotension?
Among the gram-negative, Pseudomonas.
Pseudomonas.
Klebsiella and E. coli and all, you won't see.
So, routinely also with gram-negative, you will see hypotension?
Yes. Routinely, gram-negative, you see hypotension, among which Pseudomonas is the most prevalent organism in dengue fever.
And dengue hemorrhagic fever?
Dengue hemorrhagic fever is nothing but platelets shortage as well as platelets transformation to non-adherence. So, dengue hemorrhagic fever is something that you see hemorrhage along with dengue, along with the low platelets. But it should not scare you. Dengue hemorrhagic fever is only talking about platelets. Platelets contribution, platelets way of reaction and all.
At what level of platelets you will transfuse platelets?
I wouldn't transfuse. Unless the patient is really bleeding. I would just give folic acid. I forgot to tell you. Folic acid, if you give 5 mg once a day, it should help platelets a lot.
Mm-hmm.
Dengue also eats folic acid. A lot of dengue patients have deficiency of folic acid deficiency. So that is why platelets are getting dropped. So if you give folic acid, it should help.
What about the APTT role in dengue management?
No role.
APTT?
No role.
If the APTT is...
APTT only when the liver goes into failure.
If
the patient is day 4, day 4 after patient become really sick, by the time you usually see all these elevations, APTT and all.
When the APTT is elevated, hemorrhagic tendency is very much?
It's not related to APTT. It's only related to platelets and their adherence. So, in any hemorrhagic fever or in any low platelets, folic acid should help. Folic acid tablet should help. More than platelets, it's a drop of WBC count that also need to be taken into consideration. If the drop of WBC count less than 1000, you would definitely want to start folic acid right on first day. If the drop of platelets less than 10,000, you want to start folic acid. Otherwise, you need not even start folic acid. Along with folic acid, you need to give potassium syrup to help build in the cells, cell wall.
And what about L-arnitine when hepatic liver enzymes is elevated?
When there is hepatic failure, it helps with reducing hepatic encephalopathy, but not necessarily. By the time antibiotics would not help. If the INR, INR is more than 2, if the INR, PT-INR is more than 2, then none of the antibiotics would help. By the time all the damage has already happened. Unless the patient's INR is greater than 2, you may not want to shift the patient. You can safely try vancomycin and dalbavancin. If the INR is less than 2, that means the septic class is doing whatever may be the liver enzymes and bilirubin and creatinine, you can definitely start vancomycin and dalbavancin right in the first hour and it should help.
Start.
So let me clarify my point here, and there is no relation between the antibiotic startage and counts of WBC and platelets. Antibiotics are only being needed if the bilirubin or creatinine is more than 1.5 or if the liver and OTPT more than 100, not GGT. Only folic acid is needed if the platelets are low, that means less than 10,000 platelets and 1,000 WBC. Antibiotics are not related to low platelet count or WBC count.
How much is the folic acid?
5 milligrams.
5 milligrams.
You can even give 15 milligrams. 5 milligram T 3 times a day.
Okay. Now, what about role of methylprednisolone on any steroid when there is ascites or pleural effusion?
There is no role of steroids in dengue fever. If the patient has septic shock, like any other septic shock, hydrocortisone helps improving the blood pressure. If the patient has septic shock, patient has low blood pressure, like any other septic shock, it helps improving the blood pressure.
So in ultrasound, if you have pleural effusion or
pleural effusion or any ascites are all related to virus, viral pathology. Whereas liver enzyme elevation, creatinine elevation are related to septic process.
So you routinely you don't give any steroid.